God always gives man time to repent. He even had a little longer than the 100 years or 120 years or so that Noah preached that it was going to rain, or that the flood of water was going to come, that God was going to destroy the earth by water. And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. We are preaching and warning people about the rapture, and how many people actually really believe it? We really don't even believe that the rapture is happening, is going to take place. Let me see if we really believe it or not. How many of y'all have plans to go to work tomorrow? You don't have to raise your hand. You already have plans to go to work tomorrow. You already have plans for the kids to go to school. You already have plans for tomorrow, for the next day. Now, I know you have plans, because I got plans too. Not to go to work. Let me say amen. But other plans. So we really don't believe that Jesus is coming. Because if we believe that Jesus was really coming, would we really be preparing to go to work tomorrow? Or would we even be preparing to get our, concerned about getting our kids ready for school? Even some of the bills that we have. Maybe you might have made an agreement with Consumer Power to keep your bill from getting cut off, and they put you on a settlement agreement for the next 3 months. Do we really believe that Jesus is coming? We don't really believe as we ought to, and that includes myself. So we're going to have to ask God to what? To help us. Can we say amen? To help us to really believe. Now, of course, we just can't stop living, but you think about it. If we knew Jesus was coming tomorrow, if we really knew that he was coming, what would we be doing now or today if we really believe that he was coming tomorrow? Something to think about, isn't it? Well, we just need to ask God to help us. Is that right? All right. Well, we just want to show you this, that the name Methuselah, and there's not a lot of people that know are aware of that. The only thing they know about Methuselah is that he lived to be 969 years. Now, his name reflects the prophecy that his father gave concerning a flood that was going to occur 969 years later. Isn't that something? All right, that's what we should have showed you first before we actually started on the judgment of the flood, so it's kind of out of sequence, maybe, and we hope that you're getting it. Now, we're going to deal with the fourth judgment, which is the judgment of the nation of Israel. Now, God told Israel that if they fail to hearken to his word and keep his commandments, that he was going to judge them. He warned them over and over again. He told them that when you go into the promised land, take heed to all of the commandments and the statutes that I have given you, because if you don't take heed, God said, I'm going to curse you. And of course, Moses, in his last address to Israel, warn them again. They were warned time and time again. And if you ever studied the history of Israel, and I'm going to bring that list of all of the things that nations have done to Israel, it is a fact that the most oppressed people there ever was the nation of Israel. Now, they like to talk about the black man and all of the things that he went through. Yes, the African-American did go through some things, but there has been no race of people that have suffered so much oppression than the nation of Israel. And as we told you before, the population of Israel is around 8 million over there in their land. Their land is something like 8,500 square miles. And I think Michigan is something like 96,000 square miles. That includes all of the lakes and all those type of things. And Michigan has about 9,910,000 people in it. So if you do the math, you can figure just how much larger Michigan is to Israel. And yet, where she sits in the midst of all of her enemies, right there near the border of the Mediterranean Sea, right around there, you would think that her enemies could just all converge upon her, if you look at it on the map, and just push her out into the Mediterranean Sea and destroy them. But God has, even though that they are cursed and that they are under judgment, God is still protecting them because Israel is still his inheritance. And they have the baddest army on the face of the earth, with the exception of the United States. And they probably could give us a run for our money. Because, see, Israel has a different philosophy about war. They believe in total war. See, Israel operates like this. If you got some terrorists holding up in a house, they're going to blow the whole house up. There ain't going to be no trying to get in and rescue anybody else. No, they're just going to annihilate the whole house. That's what they call total war. That's what Israel believes in. And of course, she has been very successful as far as her survival is concerned, because God has been protecting her yet until this day. And he will always fight for Israel. However, Israel has been under judgment because of her sins. And of course, and when Jesus came, they rejected him. It just brought more sin upon them. Now, in Leviticus chapter 23, I believe it's Leviticus 23. Look at my notes here. We're going to read that. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 23, verse 14 through 19. The judgment of the nation of Israel. And the reason why this judgment is so significant is because it made the way for us to have an opportunity for salvation. All right, Leviticus chapter 23 and verse 14 through 19. All right. 23:14-19. All right, let's read. And ye shall eat neither bread, nor parched corn, nor green ears, until the selfsame day that ye have brought an offering unto your God. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations and all your dwellings. Let's read. And ye shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath, from the day that ye brought the sheaf of the wave offering, 7 Sabbaths shall be complete. Even unto the morrow after the 7th Sabbath shall ye number 50 days, and ye shall offer a new meat offering unto the Lord. Now he is establishing the feast that they were to celebrate. All right, and I don't know why we're calling this scripture, because this has no apparent bearing on what we're talking about, because this is dealing with the 7 feasts of Jehovah, so I must have wrote down the wrong scripture. So we'll just stop right there. But to make this point, verse 14 through 19, I don't know why we have that scripture. But anyway, we can just scratch that, because that doesn't have any bearing on what we're talking about. But in Deuteronomy chapter 28, we're not going to read that, but Deuteronomy 28. In Deuteronomy 28, you have 68 verses in Deuteronomy 28. The first 14 of those verses is God telling Israel that if you walk according to my word, I'm going to bless you. Let's go there, Deuteronomy chapter 28. We're not going to read the entire chapter. You should read in your spare time. It is very chilling in this chapter. And we're just not going to read it, because it's just too much to read and give you something to read in your hearing. But the first 14 verses deals with blessings. The last 54 verses deals with curses. And we'll show you that as we read on. But let's read Deuteronomy 28, verse number 1. Let's read. And it shall come to pass. You there? Can we say amen? Y'all there? Deuteronomy 28, y'all there? All right, let's read. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above what? All nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, blessed shalt thou be in the field, blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kine, and the flocks of thy sheep. Now he goes on and continues to announce all of the blessings he's going to give them. However, in verse 15, let's read that there, verse 15. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee. And what? And he announces that throughout the entire chapter, what he's going to do to them if they forsake his commandments. Let's pick it up and read verse 63 down to verse 67. All right. And let's read. And it shall come to pass that as the Lord rejoiced over you to do you good and to multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to what? Can you imagine God rejoicing over them to do what? To destroy them. Let's read. And to bring you to nothing, and ye shall be plucked from off the land whither thou goest to possess it, and the Lord shall scatter thee among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest, but the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart, and failing of eyes, and sorrow in mind. And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have none assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even. And at even thou shalt say, would God it were morning. For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou what? Shall see. That is what Israel is going through right now. Now, of course, Hitler decided that he wanted to kill all of the Jews. And according to record, he exterminated something like 6 million Jews that lived in Germany and the surrounding areas, particularly Germany. And of course, they call it the Holocaust. Well, if you think that's bad, Israel went through a whole lot more stuff than what they went through in the Holocaust. And all of that was the judgment of God upon them. And even to this day, the judgment of God is still upon them, all because they failed to hearken to the commandments of the Lord. Now, when you deal with Israel in prophecy, according to the Bible, dealing with Israel in prophecy, when they went in to spy out the land, remember God had delivered them out of the hands of the Egyptians, using Moses, the purpose of them leaving Egypt was to go where? To the promised land. Is that right? And it was only supposed to be a 51-day journey. But because of their unbelief, a 51-day journey turned out to be a 40-year wandering in the wilderness. Because when they went in to spy out the land, when they got to the brink of the promised land, the land of Canaan. And according to history, the Canaanites were some of the most wicked people. They were the most wickedest people upon the face of the earth at that time. And so that's why God was going to wipe them out and use Israel to go in at that time to possess the land. Now, of course, God told Moses to send in 12 spies to spy out the land. They went and spied out the land for 40 days. 10 of the spies came back and gave an evil report, said there's giants in the land. There's no way we can overtake them. We are as children in their sight. And only two of the spies, Caleb and Joshua, said, let's go in and possess it at once. And the 10 spies that came back and gave an evil report poisoned 2.5 to 4 million people. And they began to weep and cry and accuse God of bringing them out there in that wilderness to die. And God said, I had enough with Israel. He said, you have tempted me 10 times in this wilderness. But he said, just as you said that you were going to die out here in this wilderness, God said, I'm going to let it happen just like you said. For every day that you spied out the land, I'm going to consider a year for a day. And that for 40 years, you're going to wander in this wilderness and die until everybody that lived during that time is passed off the scene. And your children, whom you say would be a prey to the enemy, are the ones that are going to possess the land. And 40 years later, it did happen under Joshua. Because after Moses died and Joshua took over, Joshua defeated 31 kings and went in there and possessed that land. So God's judgment for Israel is a year for a day. Every day that they spied out the land, he counted it a year. Now, a Gentile prophetic period in dealing with Israel is always a year for a day. Now, in the book of Leviticus, I thought it was chapter 23, but in the book of Leviticus, 4 times God tells Israel that if they backslide when they go into their promised land, after all that he did for them, 4 times he told them that I'm going to punish you 7 times more for your sins. Let me see if that is in that 23rd chapter. Maybe that's what I was trying to get to. Maybe I just had the wrong verses. But 4 times he tells them that he's going to punish them 7 times more for their sins. Now, keep in mind then that a Gentile prophetic period is in 360-day cycles. Or in other words, Israel's year totals 360 days. Ours is 365 and a quarter, and then we have a leap year, what, every what? 2-3 years or something like that? But Israel's days are 360 days in their year. Now, God told them he was going to punish them 7 times for their sins. So if you multiply 7 times 360, you get 2,520 days. And because God considers a year for a day, then that 2,520 days winds up being 2,520 years. So they went into the promised land and backslid, and what God told them was going to happen to them happened. And that 2,520 years is known as the times of the Gentiles, of which the Gentiles would rule over the nation of Israel, and that God's judgment will be upon them for 2,520 years. Now, I want you to know at least 2,500 of those years have already passed, according to the Bible. And we'll get to that in just a moment. So, their judgment as far as the 2,520 years began when Nebuchadnezzar came and took them into captivity. And they were in captivity for 70 years. And then they came out. Can we say amen? And they came out and started building there. And Cyrus and the Medes and the Persians came in, overthrew the Babylonian Empire. And then Cyrus allowed them to go back and rebuild their cities, rebuild their temple. They built Zerubbabel's temple. And then time came down to where Jesus came on the scene. And Herod's temple was standing at that time. But because they rejected Jesus, he wept and said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest those that God would send unto you, how often would I have gathered you as a chicken gather her brood, but you would not." He said, "Behold, your house is left unto you desolate." In other words, you already went through the judgment of being carried away into Babylon. Now I come on the scene and you reject me, you're going to have further judgment. And he wept and cried for Jerusalem because he knew that Titus and his army was going to come in Jerusalem and destroy and slaughter over 1 million Jews. Fact of the matter is, Nebuchadnezzar, when he came and invaded Jerusalem, slaughter was very great. And history says, I believe it's in the writings of Josephus, that Nebuchadnezzar marched 600,000 of the Jews down to the Mediterranean Sea and drowned them in the sea. That was 600,000. Some of the other ones he carried away captive. So Israel's judgment, they are under judgment right now. They don't have a temple. They can't keep any of God's feast days. She is constantly under the threat of extinction by the Arab nations that are around her. And the reason why you have ISIS and all of these other terrorist groups, and the reason why they hate the West, which is us, is because of our affinity with the nation of Israel. Satan is still trying to not just to destroy the church, he wants to destroy Israel also. Can we say amen? And so Israel's judgment, the judgment of God upon Israel, because Israel was supposed to be an example to the world. God said, "I'm going to punish you 7 times more for your sins." Now, we could get off into all of the brutality of Israel and during the Crusades, how they were brutalized and tortured during the Crusades and by Muhammad, by the Islamists and all those type of people, but I think it'd just be a waste of time. But if you do your research in history, you'll find that Israel, that nation of people, has gone through some things. And they have gone through some things is because of the judgment of God. And the judgment of God come upon them because of their rebellion. Can we say amen? All right, now, because of their rejection. God knew Israel was going to reject him. He knew they were going to go in that promised land and not do right. Even Moses knew it. And so God had a contingency plan, as we should say, because nothing takes him by surprise. In his foreknowledge, he knew everything was going to happen. And he used Israel, used their fall, to give an opportunity for non-Jews, Gentiles, to have an opportunity for salvation. But let's look at what Moses had to say to him. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter number 30. Then we're going to go to the New Testament. Deuteronomy chapter 30. And let's read. We're not going to read all 20 verses, but in your spare time, you can read the whole chapter. Deuteronomy chapter 30. You should read the whole chapter, but we're going to break in the middle of it here for time's sake. Let's pick it up in verse number 15. Let's read. "See, I have set before thee this day life and good, what? And death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways, to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply, and the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. But if thine heart turn away, so that thou wilt not hear, but shalt be drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I denounce unto you this day that ye shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land whither thou passest over Jordan to go to possess it. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed, what? See, it's so much, such big consequences when God's people do not obey the commandments of God. See, Satan cannot take our salvation from us. If he can trick us and deceive us into giving it up, and at the same time make us think that there's no consequences behind it or that it's okay, then he can get us. Because he knows, see, he is a tacticianist. He uses skill to try to get God's people. Because he knows that if he can just get us to not listen to God or be disobedient, he knows that that's the thing that will turn God against us. Now, that's why the Lord is so merciful. Can you say amen? That's why he's so merciful. Because he knows, David said, he knows the way that I take. God knows how frail we are. And he understands the power that is against us. That's why he's given us the baptism of the Holy Ghost. As long as we allow the Spirit to lead us and to guide us, it will always take us where truth is. But if the enemy can get in there and try to trick us into not allowing the Spirit of God to lead us and guide us, he knows that if he can put us at odds with God, then he knows that we have no chance. No chance. And if he did these things to Israel, and they didn't even have the Holy Ghost, how do you think it will go? Well, as the Hebrew writer said, how shall we escape if we neglect what? So great salvation. You see, God did not save us to die and go to hell. Can we say amen? That's not what he saved us for. He didn't do all of those things for Israel to curse them. That's not what he wanted. His will was for them to go in and to be his people. And that's what his will is for us. It's not his will that any should perish. As a matter of fact, in the book of, I think it is Jeremiah, he says, God says, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. He gets nothing, no pleasure out of that. But the pleasure he gets is that the wicked would live. And precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of what? His saints. And he is doing all that he can to help us to be saved. And it's unfortunate that many of God's people will not reciprocate back to him, even though he's doing all that he can. Remember, he said in the book of Revelation, he said, behold, I stand at the door and what? And knock. In the fifth chapter of Song of Solomon, the person answers, but he's gone. And it's too late. I had a preacher call me about some questions, and I talked with him about the fifth chapter of Song of Solomon. He said he'd never heard it before in his life. I said, well, you're hearing it now. Thank God for teaching. Is that right? Yeah. So, this was serious. Walking with God is the most serious thing we ever encountered in our life. And he has privileged us with the opportunity to have it. Can we say amen? You know, and so death and life is set before us. We have to choose to walk with God every day. We got to choose to be saved every day. We just didn't choose it when we got baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost. We got to choose it every day. Now, I'm going to teach a Bible class after we get done with this, Seven Judgments of God. I'm going to teach a Bible class on the deceivableness of unrighteousness. Paul talked about the deceivableness of unrighteousness, that there is a deceitful component when it comes to unrighteousness that we need to be aware of. And that's why we've got to live holy. As long as you live holy and walk with God, you will never have to worry about being deceived. You will never have to worry about being lost. As a matter of fact, we should walk with God so to where we know that we're going into rapture, that we know we're ready. Walk around looking for the rapture. Can you say amen? That's how we're supposed to be. How many of God's people you think are actually doing that? Actually looking for the rapture. I was talking to one minister, and he said they don't have foot washing services in their church. He said their pastors never wash feet, ever. And somebody asked me, what about that? I said, well, Jesus said, if I, your Lord and Master, have washed feet, you ought to what? Wash one another's feet. Even the Pope washes feet. Did you know that? And he's the head of the false church system. I saw him bow down and wash the feet of 12 of his cardinals. Then he went into a prison and washed the feet of some prisoners. And this man don't have a spoonful of Holy Ghost. The head of the false church system, but has enough humility to stoop down and wash somebody's feet. And these folk ain't even in the church. And you mean to tell me we can't wash our brother and sister's feet? Jesus said, I have given you an example that you should do as I have done unto you. There's going to be a lot of surprises when the rapture takes place. The very ones we thought were not going to be there are going to be there. And the ones that we thought that was not going to be there, or did I just say that? Well, whichever way you want to put it. Can we say amen? But it don't matter about who you're going to be surprised about. You just make sure that you are there. And as long as you follow the teachings of this church, you will be in the rapture. Because that's where I'm going. Songwriter said, I'm going over yonder to be with my Lord. That's where I'm going. I'm not going to be standing outside the throne while Daniel is in the throne. That ain't going to happen to me. I'm trying to get there myself. Can we say amen? And I believe you're trying to get there too. So that's why we do what the Bible say do. That's why it's called Greater Bible Way. Is that right? All right. So we're running out of time. Well, let's move on. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6. Now, we're going to tie this all in and show you that for us, it's a good thing that Israel was cursed. And God set it up that way. See, God has a way of using the bad and turning it out to be good. Remember all the things that happened to Joseph? Joseph couldn't get mad at his brothers, even though they sold him to slavery. First of all, they hated him. They told their father he was dead. Lied to the father for so many years. Joseph was gone. Let me see. It happened when he was 17. By the time he was 30, he stood before Pharaoh. I think when he was 30, whatever. All those years, I think he was 37 by the time his brethren came to Egypt to buy corn. All those years, lied to their father all that time. And all those things. And when they realized it was Joseph, they said, now I told you, Reuben said, I told you to leave the boy alone. When y'all saw the anguish of his soul, he said, now we're dead men and our families are dead. And they came to Joseph and said, now our father's dead, now we are your servants. He said, oh no, you meant it for evil, but God what? He couldn't even get mad at him no more and started crying and took good care of him until he died. That's what God did with this situation with Israel. You would think that God was disappointed and let down and would give up. Oh, no. In his foreknowledge, he knew what was going to happen. And God said, I'm going to use that to still get me some glory. I'm going to get me a better people through their fall. And that's the bride of Christ. All right. Well, that's what we're going to show you. That's why this is one of the greatest judgments in the Bible, because it was through this that God was going to get his bride. And today, for the first time in the history of man, God is getting what he always wanted. What did he want? Holiness. And he's getting it right now for the first time. Well, Matthew chapter number 6 and verse 9 through 12. I think that's what we want. I hope that's what we want. 6. Lord have mercy. Let me see. No, it's Isaiah chapter 6. I'm sorry. I am making all kinds of mistakes tonight. Isaiah, that was dealing with the Lord's Prayer. We don't need the Lord's Prayer tonight. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 9 through 12. That's what we want. All right. The second mistake I made tonight. All right, well, let's read verse 9. And he said, go and tell this people, this is God talking to Isaiah, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but what? Perceive not. He's telling them to go to his people, hear indeed, but understand not, see indeed, but perceive not. Verse 10, make the heart of this people fat and make their ears heavy and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert and be what? Healed. Then said I, Lord, how long? First of all, hold it right there. This was a prophecy of Israel's blindness. That even though that they had eyes to see, they would not be able to see. Even though that they had ears to hear, they would not hear. What is he talking about? When Jesus would come. This is a prophecy concerning the coming of Jesus Christ and the fact that Israel will not be able to hear him, will not be able to see him because of their unbelief. That in fact, they would reject him. And then Isaiah asks in verse 11, how long? How long are they going to be in this condition? How long are they going to be blinded? Then said I, Lord, how long? And he answered, let's read, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land be what? Utterly desolate. Now, Bishop Haywood has an article in this book, and I taught it many years ago, The Cities of Israel and the Coming of the Lord. Israel didn't have any cities at this time. So it speaks of a future time period where they would eventually have cities. Okay? So they're going to be blinded. And he says, how long? Well, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land be utterly desolate. Verse 12, and the Lord have removed men far away, and there be a great forsaking in the midst of the land, but yet in it shall be a tenth, and it shall return and shall be eaten as a teal tree and as an oak whose substance is in them when they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the what? Now, how long are they going to be blinded? Until the middle of the tribulation period, when it looks like they are just going to be annihilated. When the Antichrist comes on the scene and demands the whole world to bow down and worship him and turn on Israel to destroy them. And this is what's going to prompt God to summon us. Matthew said he shall gather his elect from one end of heaven to the other, that's us, to come back and fight the battle again and put an end to man's government. Because Israel is about to be annihilated and he's going to come down and fight for them. That's how long they're going to be blinded. And when they see him coming, they're going to say, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him. That's when the blinders will come off and they will see that Jesus was their God all along. Let's go to St. John chapter 12, verse 37 through 47, and read Jesus quoting from Isaiah. Is that Jesus quoting from Isaiah? St. John chapter 12, verse 37 through 47. Yes, John is quoting from Isaiah, St. John chapter 12, verse 37 through 47. All right, let's read. But though he had done so many miracles before them, yet they believed not on him, that the saying of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spake, Lord, who hath believed our report, and to whom hath the arm of the Lord revealed? That's in Isaiah 53 and 1. The arm of the Lord was Jesus. To whom shall the arm of the Lord be revealed? It was already prophesied that they would reject it. This is what he's saying, that they would not believe on him, that the saying of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled. Verse 39, therefore they could not believe, because that Isaiah said again, he hath blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, that they should not see with their eyes, nor understand with their heart, and be converted. And I what? If I didn't blind them, if they could understand, they would be converted and I will heal them, but there will be no salvation for anybody else. There'd be no provision. I would not be rejected and be able to die for the sins of the world if I had opened their heart, had not hardened their heart, and not allowed them to see with their eyes, and not understand, and they be converted, and I'll heal them, there would be no salvation for anybody else. Verse 41, these things saith Isaiah when he saw his glory, and what? Spake of him, and that's in the sixth chapter where we just read. Now let's go to Luke chapter 13, verse 34 to 35. Now, many of those that believe in unconditional eternal security like to use Israel as an example. And they use that scripture that said they could not believe. Well, if you take the Bible and just use one verse and just run with that, then that's what you will think, that there was a force and a power that prevented them from believing. But that's not entirely the case, because you have to consider all the scriptures in dealing with that. And here's one of them, Luke chapter 13, verse 34 through 35. Okay, we quoted this to you. Let's read it. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. This is Jesus weeping, lamenting Jerusalem, which killest the prophets and stonest them that are what? Sent unto thee. Now, who sent them? Who sent the prophets to Israel? God. And what do? Stoned them. Killed them. How often would I have gathered thy children together as a hen doth gather her brood under her wings, and what? It wasn't so much that they could not as it was that they what? Would not. They would not believe. And God used that to extend opportunity for salvation for the entire world. Because had they would have, he never would have died on the cross. There would be no eternal redemption. Not only for them, but wouldn't even be none for us. It would be none for us, would be none for them. Because the Holy Ghost could not be given, because he had to be glorified. So God's plan was perfect, even though he was not getting what he wanted, but yet still he was getting what he wanted, because it was through their failure that opened the door for salvation. Well, you would not. Now he's weeping because he knows that something like 40 years later, Titus and his army is going to come in and destroy everything that was there at that time. And when Titus came in there, he annihilated Jerusalem and only left a portion of the wall of the city standing, which we know today is called the Wailing Wall. And they go and wail and cry at that wall, and over 1 million Jews was killed. And history says that there was such bloodshed and so much slaughter that the soldiers got sick and they just turned their backs and just let some people escape. But they just got so worn out and tired and sickening of all of that bloodshed that occurred at that time. This is why he's crying, because he let him know it didn't have to happen. These things didn't have to happen to you. But you killed my prophets. You stoned them. I would have gathered you. I would have loved you as a chicken would gather her hen. Another place it says as a chicken would gather her brood, but you would not. Isn't that something? You think about all of the people that have died in their sins, that did not have to die in their sins. All they had to do was just walk with God. I was telling somebody about that young lady. I'll never forget her, Teresa Adams. Talking about she won't marry me. She wanted me more than God. I said, you got to get saved. Didn't want to get saved. Got baptized, couldn't get the Holy Ghost. 5 years later, they found her dead in the cemetery. There's been 4 people in my lifetime that I've had personal contact with them as far as being saved, getting saved, or witnessing to them about getting saved, that have died. And God was trying to say that, I can tell you story after story. The first one I had was in high school in the 10th grade. With Diane Powell. And you can't imagine witnessing to somebody and really knowing them, and then they die when they didn't have to die. Shot herself over another man. And I remember when we graduated from high school and I got my yearbook, and thumbing through the yearbook, and there was a picture of Diane. It said, gone but not forgotten. And I just broke down crying. I said, man, it didn't even have to happen. Well, there's a whole lot of people that get themselves in condition. All they have to do is walk with God or choose God, and they just don't realize. They just get tricked by the enemy. Isn't that something? Well, verse 35, he said, behold, your house is left unto you what? It wasn't desolate yet, but he was speaking in future tense of the fact he is seeing, he has already seen it desolate. So he just said, behold, your house is left unto you desolate. Let's read. And verily I say unto you, ye shall not see me until the time come when ye shall say, blessed is he that what? And that's when he comes to fight for Israel and give them another chance to be saved. Isn't God merciful? All right, so it wasn't so much that they could not, they would not. See, if you just run with that scripture in St. John and that's it, then yeah, it would look like that God intentionally prevented them from believing. But no, it was always on them. He just knew what they were going to do and took advantage of the situation to get what he wanted. And that is a bride. And that's why he's working on us to this day. Well, I think that's all the time we have, is 8:28. And we know that the kids got to go to school tomorrow. So we're going to close. And because we have one scripture here that we got to deal with, that's 36 verses. And so we definitely don't have time for that tonight. So we will cover that on Friday. Can you say amen? And we're going to show you Friday, conclusion of this, how all of these things tied in bringing us to Christ, giving us an opportunity to be saved. Yes, ma'am. Your question? Yes.
Can you quickly run over the scriptures that you gave us
tonight? Well, we dealt with Deuteronomy 28, the entire chapter. And the entire chapter, it's first 14 verses is blessings. If they were to do what God said do, The last 54 are curses. And then, of course, Moses' last message to them, Deuteronomy 30, verse 1 through 20. And then I think you got, then you have Isaiah 6, 9 through 12. So, all right, man, that looked like some good writing there. All right, Brother Ryan. Is it a question or what?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so when Methuselah died, judgment came, which was the flood, and, you know, that judgment was water, and they drowned in this water. Did Methuselah somehow sacrifice the fact that when he died, judgment came upon the flesh with the water?
No.
Whereas when Christ died?
No, he's not a type. No, he wouldn't be a type. Yes, Pamela? Oh, 26:18 about the four times, or seven times. All right, that's Leviticus what? 26:18. Yeah, I have it written down wrong. Leviticus 26:18. If you read those verses in that chapter, it lets you know. Yes, I got it marked right here. Verse 18. I will punish you seven times more for your sins. Verse 21, I will bring seven times more plagues upon you according to your sins. Verse 24, punish you yet seven times for your sins. Verse 28, I will chastise you seven times for your sins. That's in Leviticus chapter 26. Thank you. The four times he says he's going to punish them seven times for sin. Yes. Well, you have to keep on living because we don't know when he's coming. And that doesn't mean that you stop living just because, you know, doesn't mean that you stop making plans. It does show that we really don't believe, but we can only believe as far as we can believe. And God knows that. We do need to occupy until he comes. So, yes, that would be part of that. Yes, Scala. I can't hear you. The seven trumpets are the judgments of God that have fallen upon the world. All right? That's what they are. The seven trumpets is seven judgments, it's wrath. God pouring out his wrath in the form of seven trumpets. Yes. Yes. Yes, the seven churches, each message that he had to the seven churches was addressing the issues that they had in their day. Each one of them had things that they had to overcome in their day. And now that we're down to Laodicea, the seven church age, we have our problems and all of those problems that existed in that time. That's what makes our time the most dangerous time to live in. All right? Yes, Brother Ryan. No, we don't believe. If you knew Jesus, in fact, was coming tomorrow.
Yeah, but I'm not looking at it like if he's not coming tomorrow. Like, we don't know when he's coming, right?
Exactly.
But we believe he's coming.
Yes, we do believe that he's coming. We just don't believe as we ought to believe.
He's coming the next day, but we do believe he's coming, but we just don't know when it's going to be.
No, we don't know when it's going to be, but we really don't believe. as we ought to that he's coming. Because if we believed, we wouldn't be making plans to go to work tomorrow. Now, let me help you. You might accept what I'm saying if I tell you this. I heard Bishop Paddock say this. Yeah, see, I get that all the time, see. See, when I'm teaching or saying things to people, and they're like, Bishop Paddock said, oh, okay. Now, we have to realize Bishop Paddock is not God, okay? And Bishop Paddock, because I get that all the time. Because a lot of times people don't want to take me, and I'm not necessarily talking about you, but though it did work with you. But we have to realize, because I have ministers call me and ask me, what does Bishop Paddock say? It's not so much what Bishop Paddock said, it's what the Bible says. Now, Bishop Paddock was the most accurate, the greatest Bible teacher that I know. And I agree with everything that he taught. Okay? I teach what the Father's taught. And as I say all the time, 95% of what I teach has been handed down to me. All right? And maybe only 5% I might have gotten on my own through my own studies. So when I'm teaching something, I tell you something, I know it's right. Because the Father's gave us what we have. Now, I was just listening to a Bible class that I found in my garage that dated back 1986. Bishop Paddock was teaching, and he gave that same example that I just gave you tonight. And I get that a lot, which I don't mind, you know, but a lot of times people get so hung up. Oh, if Bishop Paddock said it, oh, okay, it's not so much as what Bishop Paddock said as to what the Bible says. Because I get people call me all the time, what did Bishop Paddock teach about this, that, and the other? And I'm going to start saying, look, do you want to know what the Bible says? You want to know what Bishop Paddock said? Now, what Bishop Paddock said is what the Bible said, too. But I think people get too much hung up on that. Yes. Exactly. Now, God knows that. He knows that. We don't know when he's coming. So that's why we still make plans in case he doesn't come. But the example that he gave, an example that I'm giving, is that if we knew that he was, or if we really believed that he was coming, some of the things that we do, we would not be doing. That's the point, you know. maybe God told you to fast today and you didn't fast today. For example, if you knew Jesus was coming tomorrow and God told you to fast today, what would you be doing? If you knew Jesus was coming tomorrow and your job didn't let out to 7:00, what would you do? I got to leave early. Well, now you don't understand. I got to leave early. That's what we're saying. So we need to work on our faith and believing. That's the whole point. Because even he said, when he gave the example, and he talked about how the PAW has conventions set up. As a matter of fact, that tape was dated 77, because he announced the next conventions for the next 5 years. And folk got nervous out there. He said, well, I don't really believe either. The same as you, because I'm supposed to be, and he announced his schedule for the next week or so, the next month? He says, so, you know, we need to ask God to help us. So, yes, First Lady? Yes, we still have to be ready. That's right. 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 We have to have that mindset. We need to live as if he is coming at any time. And if we really believe that, then that is the hope that we have. And that's the reason, the motivation we live the way that we live, because Jesus is coming back. Now, people that don't live right don't believe that he's what? Coming back. That's why they do what they do. You know. But, so, all right. I know I got you there, Brother Ryan, but, yeah, so, and I, see, listen, when I teach y'all things, what I teach you is right. What I say is right. And you can't just, you have to take what we're teaching you. Now, I was supposed to start the Bible class. I don't know, I've been a little off today for some reason. Maybe I'm laying around too much, I don't know. But we're going to deal with, David talked about, I have esteemed the words of thy mouth more than my necessary food. See, when I preached on Sunday, see, I get a lot of words. I'm getting a lot more word now than I did when I was working because I'm listening to my material. When I preached to y'all talking about the thing that separated Jesus from other men was that he did things that men could not do, I got that from Bishop Golder. I listened to the fathers. I have a lot of material on the fathers. Well, Pastor, can I get? No, you have to get it from me. Yes. Yeah, how many of y'all have ever even listened to Bishop Haddock? Well, that's everybody. Well, then you all know, I, because that's where I got it from. You know, not only Bishop Haddock, I give you some of the teachings I got from my pastor. God gives it to us from his people. You know, just like you have to be taught, I have to be taught. Now, there's nobody really around to give me what I need because I'm at a certain level. So what I do is I go back over the material that I've gotten over the last 36 years. You know, and the Word of God, I heard Bishop Golder say just the other night, the Word of God is the living Word. It's alive. And because it's the living Word, you get something out of it all the time. It could be a verse that you've read many times, but because it's the living word, it's always giving life, and it can give you something out of a verse of scripture that you didn't get the last 100 times you read it, because it's the living word. It's alive. That makes sense? So, so you are getting the teachings of the fathers, because this is what's going to save us. I believe that. Now, my former pastor wanted me to train and test the young ministers in his church on the minute book.